evening, everybody. As you know, the washing of feet is an integral part of tonight's Mass. If anybody would like to have a foot wash, could you please sit on the end of a row here, and I will go down one side and back up the other, washing the foot as I go. I'm not worried about how many people, I'm not worried, men or women or children, that doesn't concern me at all. So if you'd like a foot wash, just make sure you have it sort of hanging out on the end of the row, and it will get washed. Thank you.
Thank you. let us confess, Almighty God, our sins against his love, and ask him to cleanse us. Lord, in your generosity, we see our selfishness. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, in your humility, we see our pride. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, in your loving service, we see our unconcern. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
As we sing the introduction to the Gloria, we ring our bells. Son, when about to hand himself over to death, entrusted to the Church a sacrifice new for all eternity, the banquet of his love. Grant, we pray, that we may draw from so great a mystery the fullness of charity and of life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, for ever and ever.
Amen. This day is to be a day of remembrance for you, and you will celebrate it as a feast of the Lord's honour for all generations. You are to declare it a day of festival forever. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The blessing cup that we bless is a communion for the blood of Christ.
Thank you.
Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
It was before the festival of the Passover, and Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to pass from this world to the Father. He'd always loved those who were his in the world, but now he showed how perfect his love was. They were at supper, and the devil had already put him into the mind of Judas Iscariot, son of Simon, to betray him. Jesus knew that the Father had put everything into his hands, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. And he got up from table, removed his outer garment, and taking a towel, wrapped it round his waist. He then poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel he was wearing. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "At the moment, you do not know what I am doing, but later you will understand." "Never," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus replied, "If I do not wash you, you can have nothing in common with me." "Then," said Simon Peter, "not only my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Jesus said, "No one who has taken a bath needs washing. He's clean all over. You too are clean, though not all of you are." He knew who was going to betray him. That was why he said, "Though not all of you are." When he washed their feet and put on his clothes again, he went back to the table. "Do you understand," he said, "what I have done to you? You call me Master and Lord, and rightly, so I am. If I then, the Lord and Master, have washed your feet, you should wash each other's feet. I have given you an example, so that you may copy what I have done to you." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
This evening, in churches all across the world, as they prepare for this Mass, priests will make sure that there's a jug filled with comfortably warm water, a nice clean bowl, and there'll be soft, freshly laundered towels. At the same time, they can be certain that some people will have paid meticulous attention to their feet and footwear, assuring that the acceptable cleanliness of the foot, which the priest will wash anyway as part of the commemoration of the Last Supper. Here, as in so many other churches, our musicians will rehearse the hymn, which they'll sing during the washing of the feet. Yet, for all the attention to detail, this isn't the easiest part of the church's liturgy. Most of us are not used to having washed our feet. Many priests can feel shy about such personal contact with their parishioners. Although parishioners will subsequently comment on the beauty and the meaningfulness of the occasion for both the priest and those whose feet are washed, the Mass of the Lord's Supper involves humility and sensitivity towards each other, conscious that their role is enacted before the curious eyes of family and friends, and probably some complete strangers here as well. Of course, this is the origin of the Maundy service, which was celebrated at Windsor Castle today. It used to be the tradition that the monarch would wash the feet of 12 poor people. That sort of seems to have gone out of practice, and now they just give money instead. Not quite the same thing, is it? We need to remember that Jesus and the apostles lived in a warm climate and spent their days wandering dusty roads and the none-too-clean fishing boats in which most of the apostles found their second home, and their feet were roughened and hardened by wear and tear of daily life, locally produced sandals, or walking unshod. And at the end of the day, they enjoy that momentary luxury of immersing hot and dusty feet into beautiful cold water, removing the grime and the traces of all that had gone before. A host instructed a servant to wash the feet of his guests, partly for their own comfort, and partly because he didn't want muddy footprints all through his house today. Knowing this, the apostles were shocked and highly embarrassed when Jesus proceeded to perform that task of the servant. Jesus was their leader, their teacher, and probably even more than that, that they could see and understand. And yet, here he was saying through his actions that leadership required humble service. No wonder Peter objected. He should have been washing the feet of Jesus, not the other way around. But Jesus' reply, "If I do not wash you, you can have nothing in common with me," simulated a self-conscious response. "Then, Lord, wash not only my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Typical Peter, of course. And the Lord washed not only both his leader and his servant, also demonstrated Peter's readiness to be completely open to whatever Jesus wanted. This was a lesson that none of those apostles would ever forget when they became leaders of the early church. There've been lots of paintings of this event, of the Last Supper, of the washing of the feet, so it's easy for us to have a picture in our imagination. But we can see it as something in the past, if we're not careful, something celebrated in a special way just on that Maundy Thursday. Most of us will never need to wash each other's feet. But if we stop to think about it for a moment, we are in fact daily surrounded by many examples of similar acts in our present day and age. If only we could open our eyes and see the many different ways in which people lead through their humble service of others. Parents will perform first aid on the greatest need of children rather than leaving them to attend to their own rooms. Teachers give extra time to pupils who might find a lesson difficult to understand. A bus driver will wait patiently while a passenger fumbles for his or her fare or for their travel pass. The supermarket cashier pauses for a while to greet a customer and wait for them to find the right card or the voucher. A police officer courteously can give street directions to a stranger. Nurses, care workers, sensitively help with intensely private, personal tasks which their patients can no longer perform independently. Maundy Thursday commemorates Jesus' example of humble service, but it also celebrates the many tiny acts that we can overlook or take for granted. Each and every one of us is a leader in some way or other, by virtue of our differing talents and responsibilities, and we need to say in what ways we can follow that example that Jesus gave us in washing the feet of his apostles in our modern situation. We can also follow the example of the apostles who allowed Jesus to perform that act of humble service, and in many ways, that can be more difficult for us to receive it rather than to give it. We all need to recognize that we must both give and receive the service of others. Maundy Thursday shows us the way in which we do that. And if I can ask those who would like to foot wash, please sit on the edge. Thank you. people. Yesterday, our bishop blessed the oil of the sick and the oil of catechumens, and then, together with the priests of the diocese, he consecrated the Holy Chrism. These oils will be used during this coming year in our churches in the celebration of the sacraments. The holy oils are a symbol of our unity with our bishop and with all the faithful throughout the church. On this holy night, they've been brought to the altar as a reminder of that unity and of the work of salvation carried out by our churches in the grace and power of Christ. Let us pray for those who will encounter Christ through his church, when they are strengthened to be his witnesses by these signs of the new covenant.
Let us pray.
The oil of the sick.
Let us pray that the Spirit of God may strengthen those who suffer illness, anxiety, and pain through the prayer of faith and the anointing of this oil. May they experience the healing power of Christ. May the sick who are anointed with this oil experience the compassion of Christ and his saving love in body, mind, and soul.
The oil of catechumens.
Let us pray for those who are to be anointed with this oil in preparation for their baptism, that they may accept the challenge of Christian witness and experience the joy of new birth. Family of the Church. Through anointing of this oil, may our catechumens be strengthened like Christ to resist the power of Satan and reject evil in all its forms.
Blessed be God forever.
The oil of Christ.
Children and adults who are baptized and confirmed, and priests who are ordained, experience the gracious gift of the Holy Spirit, because the Lord sent his Spirit to fill the church with every gift and complete his saving work. Let us pray for those who are to be anointed with this oil in the sacraments of confirmation and holy orders, that sealed by the Spirit, they may then be transformed into the lamps of Christ, that witness to him as they share his work of service.
Blessed be God forever.
Oh,
my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice in your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good home of his holy church.
Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that we may participate worthily in these mysteries. For whenever the memorial of this sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is accomplished. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord, for he is the true and eternal priest who instituted the pattern of an everlasting sacrifice and was the first to offer himself as the saving victim, commanding us to make this offering as his memorial. As we eat his flesh that was sacrificed for us, we are made strong, and as we drink his blood that was poured out for us, we are washed clean. And so with angels and archangels, with the thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we have kept. Similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me.
Thank you.
his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victory, by whose death you will, to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Mark, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, grant kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Thank you.
Reminder that the sacred liturgy tomorrow is here at 3 o'clock. There are stations of the cross in Mullion at 11 for those who fancy a trip out. That those stations will be followed by a walk of witness. Our walk of witness in Helston is 11 o'clock on Saturday morning. Now we transfer the this to our garden of repose. As we do so, we sing the traditional hymn for this, which is Of the Glorious Body.
Thank you. Thank you.